This is an excerpt of a letter from Dr. Silkworth that appears in the AA Basic Text, also known as the AA Big Book.
What with our ultra-modern standards, our scientific approach to everything, we are perhaps not well equipped to apply the powers of good that lie outside our synthetic knowledge.
He stated this in reference to the problem of alcoholism and the failure of the medical community of the day to come up with any respectable solutions to the problem. Dr. Silkworth wrote this in 1939 when the Big Book was published. In the same year that AA was founded, 1935.
Christmas time, the holidays. Is this the way they end for me here in this place, a mental hospital they call it? That's a fancy name, that is, but I know a better. The bug house.
The lobotomy was performed for the first time. This procedure made use of an ice pick type of surgical tool that was inserted into the brain via the eye socket to sever brain connections as a means to cure mental illness. At the time, this was considered the cutting edge and ultra-modern standard of psychiatry, or psychosurgery as it became known. During that day and age, there did not exist any effective treatment whatsoever for schizophrenia or other serious mental illness, and the lobotomy managed to make life more endurable for patients and their surroundings by just about turning them into zombies. As a rule, therapeutic methods developed considerably later in psychiatry than in other medical fields. The state of psychiatry was somewhat of a mess and had a long way to go. Violent patients, dangerous to their surroundings, sometimes had to be restrained or immersed in baths for long periods. The alternative was heavy sedation with opiate derivatives or barbiturates. However, none of these treatments had any long-term effects on psychotic patients, and most of them just ended up being institutionalized. The lobotomy was celebrated as revolutionary, and the inventor of the procedure was awarded the Nobel Prize in 1949. The use of the procedure increased dramatically from the early 1940s and into the 1950s and 60s, during the same time that AA's popularity and influence had grown exponentially. But why were lobotomies so popular? It's because the alternative, being locked up in a mental institution, was considered to be worse. It was only in 1952 that the first drug with a definite effect on schizophrenia was introduced, chlorpromazine, the world's first neuroleptic drug, and it only really became widely available in the early 70s. In 1946, the year after World War II ended, over one half of the public hospital beds in the US were devoted to the mentally ill. Most of these people were to spend their remaining days within the confines of psychiatric institutions. In the late 19th century to around the 1950s, there was also a strong sentiment of what is known as therapeutic nihilism amongst the medical professionals of the time. Therapeutic nihilism is the idea that it's impossible to cure people or societies of their ills through treatment or medication. This view was, strangely enough, especially held by medical professionals during the height of its prevalence. Oliver Holmes, a highly regarded physician and proponent of therapeutic nihilism, once said, "If the whole history of medicine, as now used, could be sunk to the bottom of the sea, it would be so much better for mankind, and all the worse for the fishes." Physicians who held this view believed that the most potent weapon for treatment was not medication, but the regulation of bodily secretion such as bloodletting, promotion of perspiration, or urination to regain the natural state of equilibrium. Modern medicine was really just a pipe dream at the time anyway. Another example of how early we were in terms of our process, penicillin, the world's first antibiotic, only became widely available in 1945. So the 1930s, 40s and 50s, the era that saw the advent of AA and its exponential increase in popularity, shared the same age that saw medical practitioners replace their therapeutic nihilism with the radical and ultra-modern technique of indiscriminately probing the frontal lobes of the mentally ill with an ice pick. Ultra-modern and scientific approach that Dr. Silkworth spoke of in his letter for the Big Book needs to be understood in this context to understand why, today, many AA fundamentalists have such a dogmatic anti-psychiatric view, and all of this is part of the reason. The sentiment is 90 years old and frozen in time. AA fundamentalists continually make reference to the first 100 men who sobered up through the AA way. They are a very sentimental bunch, and rightfully so. AA has saved millions of lives and is still set to do so well into the future. Dr. Silkworth was correct in his analysis of the era's medical competencies in relation to alcoholism and other mental illness. He was 66 years old when he wrote his famous doctor's opinion for AA in 1939. At about 66 years old, I have very little doubt that his worldview and opinions were pretty much well established, and that they had been formed by the era of therapeutic nihilism, the lobotomy, and the institutionalization of the mentally ill. Institutions, psychiatric, correctional, and otherwise, had very little idea of what was required to rehabilitate its residents and how they could be reintroduced successfully into society. Doctors could dry alcoholics out, but that's pretty much where their competencies ended. Mostly people just ended up becoming institutionalized and very few ever became well. Alcoholics seem to have terrorized the medical establishment for centuries. Dr. Silkworth's observation that alcoholism was a disease of the body and mind and not a moral failing was not revolutionary. Medical professionals have held this view since the late 18th century. The American physician Benjamin Rush, who died in 1813 and who was a signatory to the United States Declaration of Independence, understood drunkenness to be what we would now call a loss of control, and possibly the first use of the term addiction in this sort of meaning. Rush argued that habitual drunkenness should be regarded not as a bad habit, but as a disease, describing it as a palsy of the will. Already in 1802, the prominent German physician Christoph Hufeland had published a book on the brandy plague, stating that the infection with the spirits makes it inevitably necessary to drink even more. This study marked the birth of a consistent paradigm of addiction as a mental illness, although it took many decades until this view was accepted. In 1849, Swedish physician Magnus Huss coined the term alcoholism in his book Alcoholismus Chronicus. Some argue that he was the first to systematically describe the physical characteristics of habitual drinking and claim that it was a mental disease. The ideas were not new, but they were also not well known. Alcoholism was still widely thought to be a failing of morality, and these ideas just needed to be neatly packaged and marketed, and Bill W. was the perfect man for the job.
It's a place where Americans come together to break bread. I am telling you, McDonald's can be the new American church.
As a salesman, failed stockbroker, and entrepreneur, Bill Wilson, one of the founders of AA, realized that he had stumbled onto a solution for one of the alcoholic's most lacking resources. This idea is captured by Dr. Foster Kennedy, a neurologist and supporter of the AA movement, who wrote this for the big book chapter called The Medical View on AA on page 574. This organization of Alcoholics Anonymous calls on two of the greatest reservoirs of power known to man: religion and that instinct for association with one's fellows, the herd instinct. Here's another excerpt from the same chapter by Dr. Harry Tybalt, a psychiatrist. I now conceive the psychiatrist's job to be the task of breaking down the patient's inner resistance so that which is inside him will flower as under the activity of the AA program. Bill Wilson was an expert marketer and salesperson, and he perfectly understood the value of third-party testimonials, especially where medical professionals were concerned. An endorsement at the very opening of the AA text from a well-known doctor and chief physician at a nationally prominent hospital specializing in alcoholism contributed some desperately needed credibility for the idea of AA's psychic experience. Dr. Silkworth was Bill's man. I think one would be hard-pressed to find too many instances where multiple medical professionals, including physicians, psychiatrists, and psychologists, have been used to give credence to a document that makes use of the word God on over 330 occasions. Just an observation. But this wasn't enough. The custodians of the AA Big Book needed additional testimonials to, in a very subtle way, lambaste the medical fraternity as incompetent when compared to the AA psychic experience. Bill W. carefully curated this balancing act, having medical pros give credence to AA and having alcoholics tactfully denounce the medical and psychiatric establishment of the day in favor of AA's doctrine. Here are a couple of excerpts from testimonials from the fourth edition of the book. Page 308, and the psychiatrist has had thousands of couches and has put you and me on them many, many times, but this hasn't helped us very much. Page 238, I had a long talk with my psychiatrist, but nothing came of that. Page 384, to cut a long story short, I spent 7 years and $10,000 on my psychiatric adventure and emerged in even worse condition than ever. In spite of the fact that the Big Book had at least 32 authors, in April of 1939, on the copyright application form, Bill Wilson claimed sole ownership of the copyright of the Big Book for himself. Under the terms of an agreement Bill concluded with AA headquarters in 1963, Lois, Bill's widow, was allocated 13.5% of his royalties from the Big Book and three other books that he wrote for AA. Another 1.5% went to his mistress, Helen Wynn, who died a few years after Bill. In 1988, according to a New York Times article published on AA and its history, it was reported that Lois received $912,000 in royalties for the year in 1987. This works out to around $3 million, or a whopping 43 million rand in 2022's money. At the time of his death, early in 1971, Bill was earning around $65,000 a year in royalties from the Big Book. This equates to $455,000, or 6.6 million rand in 2022's money. Before I go on to tell you about Dr. Silkworth's kill rate, if you guys like this video, please remember to subscribe to our channel and like our video. It's been estimated that Dr. Silkworth consulted with around 40 to 50,000 alcoholics over the course of his lifetime. By his own modest admission, he saw his success rates at around 2%. For the starry-eyed fundamentalist, there is the problem of accounting for the 2% who were successfully treated with mere human power. The stock answer, of course, is that they weren't real alcoholics. Irrespective of the 2% by Dr. Silkworth's estimation, there were at a minimum 39,200 that he tweeted who went on to die alcoholic deaths because of his failed scientific approach. Although this doesn't take into account the number of men and women who he treated after AA was formed. If he referred half of the 40,000 to AA and all 20,000 remained sober, it puts the alcoholic death rate closer to around 16,000. This speaks to the insidiousness of alcoholism and the need for some sort of ongoing process beyond the rehabilitation process. But isn't this where a line can be drawn between what medicine can effectively do and where a person needs to start taking personal responsibility, especially in our era with all the access to supports that we could ever wish for? Aside from other programs that exist out there, AA provides a perfect solution to this problem. On any evening in most major cities around the world, there is at least one AA meeting happening. There is no excuse for alcoholics to leave a rehab program and miss out on an opportunity for association with one's fellows. Not in the way that we used to, at least, but rather in a new way where we focus on a solution to our daily struggles that excludes the use of alcohol. Dr. Silkworth recognized that there was an aspect of alcoholism that medical professionals could not be of much help. Bill W. and others provided a perfect solution to the problem, a society of men and women with a single-minded purpose of helping each other stay sober. His marketing and sales skill helped him do what others before him had tried and failed, execute the establishment of one of the greatest movements of the 20th century. It's 2022 and we're a long way from the transorbital lobotomy. There are hundreds of new methods and groups that have sprung up around the world that provide alternatives to the AA solution. There is even talk of a medication which is being hailed as a cure for alcoholism. You'll be able to take a little pill and be able to drink like a normal person without any loss of control or onset of the mental obsession. I'm a raging alcoholic myself and I only have one single question about taking one of these pills. What'll happen if we take two or seven? Just a reminder, guys, if AA meetings aren't for you and you want to participate in a support meeting via Zoom for people that are duly diagnosed, please see the links in the description of this video. And thanks again for watching. We really appreciate your support. Thanks, guys.